activity that was funded by the now Federal Energy Technology Center. Now I'm live. I think you can hear me better. The motivation for this work came from the interest of using Fischer-Tropsch catalysts in bubble-column reactors. And bubble-column reactors, if you are familiar with them, are three-phase reactors. This is a picture of the mock-up bubble-column reactor we have in our laboratory at CMDO. But I need a person standing next to it to really show you how big it is. But if I was standing next to it, my head would come to the back. The important thing, catalyst-wise, with bubble-column reactor is that your catalyst is suspended in a liquid. Usually, in a Fischer-Tropsch reaction, it starts out as a mineral oil, and as time goes on, the reaction produces its own wax. And if the catalyst falls apart, two things can happen. One, first of all, it becomes impossible to separate the catalyst from the wax. But the second thing is that as the people that work at the LaPorte facility, which is a pilot bubble-scale reactor, will tell you, if the catalyst attrits to the very submicron binds, you'll get a very viscous liquid phase. And I describe it as the bubbles come up from the bottom just like, and that's it, and they're out. There's no gas holdup. You get no reaction, virtually no reaction happening because of that. So it's very important that you want your catalyst to be small enough to react, to have good surface area to react well, but you don't want it to get any smaller because that creates all sorts of problems. So Professor Dante and myself have studied have tried to look at this whole attrition process, and our tact has been to look at the phase transformations and the carbon deposition that takes place on the catalyst during reaction. And we have started out as simply as possible. We did small reactions, fixed bed reactors on atmosphere, simple as we could. And basically we found out we started with an oxide catalyst, iron oxide, and it would be activated CO or a combination of the two, depending what you activated it in, get magnetite or some carbide going on it. You could reduce it all the way to alpha iron. And then once you reacted it in syngas, then you got iron carbide. Sometimes it could be reoxidized in magnetite if there was a lot of water around. Sometimes you saw the carbon on the surface turn to graphite, become graphite. Graphitic type carbon. You had to really cook it to get graphite, but there was quite a bit of graphitic carbon. And I want to show you some of the pictures we got using high resolution TEM during these experiments. And what I'm going to show you, what this is now, is just an activity plot. This is methane formation over several catalysts versus time that were pre-treated differently, and these show the different pre-treatments. And what I'm going to look at is the one that were pre-treated in CO and hydrogen with Fischer-Tropsch mixture at 523 Pa, 523 Pa. So that's the blue line and the red line here. And you see that the blue one, it starts out, shows no activity at all, but both of them end up being very similar in the long run. And the red one is active right from the beginning. That's the one that was pretreated at higher temperatures. So let me show you. Right after activation at the lower temperature one, so that's right here, this is what it looked like. So at 523 degrees, just seeing it for 2 hours, and all we could see was magnetite. And it was what Abaya and I call Swiss cheese sort of morphology of magnetite. We couldn't find any carbide, it was beautiful magnetite. Okay. This was the one that didn't have any activity. So I think that makes one of the biggest points that I can make today. that there is some carbide formation. There is that still that magnetite Swiss cheese morphology. That's how you can tell it's still magnetite. What you see here is a little carbide. And not only is it a carbide, but it's a carbide bud. It looks like it's a little buds out from the magnetite. Well, you know, whether that's usual or not, you can look, if you look farther on down the road, say at 10 hours here, after it's been exposed for quite a while, you see that this budding is very characteristic of the way the carbide forms. The bulk is still, there's still a lot of magnetite there, but these carbide buds keep forming. And not only are they carbide buds, but around the edge, you'll see there's a sort of halo of carbonaceous material around the loop. But there's none. If you look at this area here, you can see it more, a little better. Well, maybe you can't, I don't know. If you could see it, the original picture, you could probably see that this is a more regular structure than this around the edge. This is carbide, and this is the carbonaceous material. Now, we only saw carbonaceous material on the carbide, never saw it on the magnetite. And some supporting evidence we had for that was in our XPS work of these catalysts, or similar catalysts, actually. And that is that in our XPS work, we never saw any iron carbide unless we etched it first. We etched off some layers, we could see iron carbide. And that was also evidence that all the iron carbide was hidden below. So after only 45 hours at one atmosphere, that's the blue line right there, it's not even the most active catalyst. Let me show you this. You can see that if you had this in a bulk com reactor, you'd have trouble because we're starting to break down into very small amounts. The whole crystal is breaking down into small carbide pieces. And actually, this is the catalyst that broke down the pilot plant bubble column in Texas that caused all that trouble. You can see why it did. So at this point, we said two things. We said, well, it seems like carbide is necessary for the reaction to take place. And two, that over carbide, there's always a carbonaceous material. And three, it's that those things, both the phase transformation and the carbonaceous material, which seem to cause it to attrit. So now we definitely have a problem. So we did some temperature program reaction studies. This is just a typical. There's nothing special about this, except for the fact that. We do the reaction, we react the catalyst in the same place where we do the temperature program reduction reaction. So that way it will never have to be exposed to oxygen. So it's an in situ TPR. It's basically what it boils down to. So we can, and this is a steel reactor, stainless steel reactor, so we actually can react things at higher pressures. And then we can vent the reactive gases, and then when we do the TPR, then we can just analyze it down. Now, I want to show you why it's really important, some pretty dramatic examples of why it's really important to do it in situ. I just think they're kind of neat looking. This just is magnetite. This is not, the only thing I want to show you is this is what magnetite looks like. On a freshly calcined catalyst. Just these nice regular patterns, very crystalline, highly crystalline. So if this has been calcined and you put it in the TM, that's what it looks like. Right. If you get magnetite due to poor passivation, appetite to, or we can guess anyway, we don't really know for sure, but we can guess whether it's magnetite due to passivation troubles or whether it's oxide that originally started out as oxide. So I just wanted to show you that so you'll know as time goes on. Anyway, our what we did for our TPRs is we would react them for 24 hours, and if we did it much longer than that, we would build up so much wax we could never get it off. So that was pretty much the limit on the length of our reaction that we could do, and we could pick a temperature, or and we could go up to 220 PSI GMU or so. And then we would do that for 24 hours. We would have to blow helium through the catalyst for quite a period of time to get rid of the wax so that it wouldn't get in the way of our temperature program reaction here that we do later. And one of the things that we do that's different than maybe some other people is that we hold, when we raise the temperature, we hold it at 270 degrees, and that's where we seem to the reason we do that is to get rid of all that carbonaceous material that rings, that halos, the catalysts. In fact, I want to just show you, this is a 1% copper that actually, right here, this is, unfortunately it's not very clear, this is a magnetite particle that never got exchanged in this one. This is a 1% copper catalyst. And what happened is that we did temperature propane reduction and stopped it right here. So, this first peak is just the carbonaceous material. What we should see is carbide without any of that covered on, and that's exactly what we saw. There's carbide here, which is a magnetite that's never converted. In fact, they were pretty, I thought they were pretty weird pictures, because I'd never seen carbide without its covering before. There we have lots of them. So it was a very, that's part of, it was a very reactive carbonaceous material. It all came off at 270. And then, and I guess I'm just really showing you here that this is, and that this second peak that we found here was a carbide peak. But this peak too appears to be a carbide peak as well. Because although the, after this peak, you mostly see alpha iron. This is an alpha iron peak. This is a passivation layer. There is a small amount of carbide left, although quite a bit of alpha iron. This is a mixture of alpha iron and bits of carbide. So anyway, so what I'm trying to say here is that you have, basically, you have three peaks when you do, if you don't go to too high a temperatures in your temperature program reduction. And you can quantitatively measure the amount of amorphous carbides, and carbides. These we never went over 550, so we didn't start getting into the therapeutic material. And the whole point is that we did a series of, in this one, we did a series of copper catalysts, 1% to 10% in no copper. And you'll see that we did it at different temperatures. Now, 270 degrees, the reaction at 270 degrees, we know from experience that a lot of attrition takes place at 270 degrees in a catalyst. And so, rather than 215, even in a 24-hour period. So, the conclusion of the slide is that these different carbides contribute to that sort of attrition of the catalyst. It's also, of course, more active, which is part of the frustration. If you do, we did a series of potassium. This is virtually impossible. very catch-22 catalyst. It's like the more you make it active, the more it seems to attrit as well. And that's, so we're saying the things that traditionally make this more active, adding potassium, adding copper, are also the things that make it fall apart. And you can see why, because there's more carbon deposition that pushes those, the crystallites apart, and there's more morphology changes between the magnetite and carbide and the different kinds of carbide. And those may have volumetric changes associated with them, which is also what separates them from one another because they switch. Okay, now what I'm going to show you are a series of catalysts that were tested by Bert Davis in Bert's lab in a autoclave reactor for a very long period. Longer than I could ever do anything like that. But anyway, it's he has an automatic cell. And these are a series of catalysts that were activated at different conditions. And what we did, samples were drawn from this experiment at the points along where the arrows are. And we looked at them X-ray diffraction to see what they were. And there really wasn't a whole lot of deactivation, and that's a pretty good long time. Okay. Because one of the main carbide peaks here, 2.41, is underneath the magnetite peak, it's hard to compare. You can't use that carbide peak to ratio your magnetite carbide, so we use this one and ratio it to this magnetite peak to get our ratio of magnetite to carbide ratio. And I have them, I jotted them down right here. You see 3.7, 4.0, 3.4, and 3.9 is what's going on. And so, perhaps within experimental error, there isn't a lot of difference between these two. You can't really use that as a reason for why there is a small amount of deactivation during the course of the reaction. As if you remember, it wasn't a lot. But what is really interesting, I think, in this whole story is that right here, there it is. This is alpha iron. And so, and this was this catalyst was originally reduced in hydrogen. So, you know, could be alpha iron that was left over from the original reduction. Maybe not. Why wasn't there any alpha iron in the other ones? Our guess is that they weren't withdrawn in such a way. Alpha iron is so sensitive to oxidation, and we believe they probably weren't withdrawn properly to maintain the integrity of the alpha iron in the other samples. It was just sort of a coincidence in this one that we did. In fact, we took that same sample and looked at it 9 months later. This is in July, and we looked at it in March. And you'll see it's gone. It was sitting in the wax in a nice little tight bottle and, you know, in a place where you'd think it would be secure. But iron is so sensitive to oxidation that you lose that. So, you know, I hope that if you take anything from my talk, and that is that when you work with iron catalysts and Fischer-Tropsch, that there is such a sensitivity to oxidation that I think that that explains a lot of the controversy throughout the years as far as what goes on iron catalysts, because they do oxidize so easily. There are two more catalysts, very similar to the last one. They were just pre-treated differently. One in CO and hydrogen, and one in CO. And this one reacts at So from the catalyst that was activated in CO, you can see once again this is alpha iron, so we really do have alpha iron. So that this shows that alpha iron is part of the equilibrium of the Fischer Tropsch reaction. So we have carbide, we have alpha iron, and we have magnetite, and that seems to be some kind of equilibrium process. This, it can't be left over from the activation since we activated the CO. We have some HRTEM micrographs of these, and I think what's most interesting about them is that they basically look like the ones I showed you at the beginning of the talk that were done at one atmosphere in a fixed bed reactor. And that is, you have carbide particles, and they have a carbonaceous film. It's harder to see them in this because it's virtually impossible once you've reacted that length of time to get some of this wax. Maybe you can see it better here. It's just a little carbonaceous film around that carbide. This is wax, but they all have all the carbide particles. Maybe you can see it better here. This is the carbonaceous layer. This is the wax. Once again, there was another catalyst run. It had a mess. Anyway, this is made only from iron. This was a mistake here. This is a fused iron catalyst, and I'm using this as catalyst. And you can see that the conversion here was much lower than the other three that we had. When we went to look at the catalyst in the X-ray diffraction sample taken towards the end, you'll see we have a lot of magnetite. And in fact, the ratio of magnetite is to carbide is 6.33, which I think explains its lack of activity. And when we look at it under the TM, you get a lot of magnetite. Clearly, magnetite is not active. There's some that's termic carbide. It's hard to see it and find it, but there's just a lot of magnetite. They're hollow spheres of magnetite. So anyway, in conclusion, we didn't really see the catalyst compositions change much over time. And over the long samples we did, the pretreatment and activation didn't seem to make much difference. Clearly, carbide was required for the catalyst to work. Magnetite did not seem to be a good thing to have. And alpha iron somehow is thrown into the mix. It's part of the equilibrium iron mix. Potassium increases the carbonaceous material found on the catalyst during reaction, which contributes to its attrition as well as its activity. And increasing the reaction temperature produces carbides, which reduce the higher temperatures in the copper promoting catalyst and also cause faster attrition in the catalyst. And most important, protection of the sample against oxidation is critical for understanding the true nature of an iron catalyst. I'd be glad to answer any questions if you have any. Which helped to prevent the...
Oh, you don't form carbide.
Right. Yeah. So they run cobalt as one. And the other thing is now Sasol runs with iron. Okay. And the way they do it, first of all, they have a special, they got rid of their pneumatic system for putting in the catalyst. So there's not this physical, any physical attrition putting the catalyst. And they put it in, they never take it over 215 degrees C, which is why I use 215 as my low temperature here. They have a specialized separation system, a very fancy one that they've developed and patented, where they separate the wax from the catalyst. In three, they only use their catalyst for 2 weeks. They feel that iron is expendable. So that's how they do it. But I'd say the majority of people just give up and use cobalt. And my understanding too is that Sasol is, they're doing a lot of research into developing cobalt catalysts themselves.
Cal?
Nancy, I wondered why these different activation treatments had such little impact on the activity of the catalyst. As you know, we did some collaboration with you and in reducing the same catalyst to 450 degrees centigrade in hydrogen, we found evidence that we completely deactivated the catalyst. There's apparently sulfur present in the catalyst and it was coming to the surface. What temperature did you reduce this catalyst in hydrogen? And are you telling me then that, that if I reduce it at a lower temperature in hydrogen, I'm not going to have the problem with the sulfur?
Yeah, if you, my experience has been if you reduce the catalyst all the way to alpha iron, I mean all the way, which at 450 would definitely do that long enough.
Our MOSFIR showed that it was all essentially all alpha iron.
Right. Then you're out of luck. I mean, that's when it goes to, that's when any sulfur contamination goes straight to the surface. I actually noticed that I had still had this thing in here that I think I have. This is one of these catalysts. I don't know why I can't believe I have this with me. But anyway, we did that with this catalyst. This is an iron catalyst, like the one you were talking about. We reduced it all the way to alpha iron, and then we put it in synthesis gas, 5-4-3-2 metal, and then in synthesis gas. And we got bulk carbide to actually form, but never reacted, because the sulfur was on the surface. But somehow, sulfur didn't prevent the carbide from fusing in and forming carbide, but it did create some kind of surface
sulfide
that prevented the reaction, the Fischer-Tropsch reaction in particular.
You're reducing in hydrogen though at 543.
But we went to the metal. It took us 20. But what I'm saying is that it doesn't matter what temperature, as long as you take it to the metal. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. But when we reduced it essentially 773 Kelvin,
yeah,
then what we found, and this was by a series of in situ MOSFIR measurements, that when you reduced, you got alpha iron. When you exposed it to carbon monoxide, still had alpha iron.
Oh, really?
Yeah, when you exposed it to hydrogen and CO, you still had alpha iron. So. In other words, there wasn't anything we could do to that. And when we exposed it to air, we still had, you know, so everything had no impact on it.
Rod, if you went to that high of temperature, I think it would more resemble like the fused iron catalyst.
Right.
The iron core is so large with such low surface area that
it
remains and dominates. We've seen the same thing with the United Catalyst, C73.
We haven't lost probably as much surface area as you have just producing in 273.
I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
Now, you do long fixed bed reactor studies in that little gas space.
Uh-huh.
And what conversions were you getting at?
Very low.
Process that you're doing as well. Is that
Yes, that's their
Terry?
Yes, I'm fascinated by what Al said, what I see here. Your analyses that you presented today were all done after the reaction, the diffraction. And I'm wondering whether they actually truly represent the situation and the reaction of the condition. Do they mean in situ must
I think that you're right, that most of the X-ray diffractions that we have here do not represent exactly what went on. Since this time that we've done this work, actually Cecil came to the University of New Mexico and they did a lot of experiments regarding exactly how you can do it and how you can't do remove catalyst from a slurry gun reactor. And it's extraordinarily sensitive and you have to, the wax is not enough. You know, when it's hot like that, you have to do it in an inert atmosphere. Well, the magnetite, you can understand why there would be a certain amount of magnetite because now a fixed bed reactor, you do a big fixed bed reactor study in a real, especially in a real situation, you know, the first part of your bed will deactivate because you've got sulfur, catch yourself with sulfur. In the bottom end of your bed will deactivate because it's magnetite. And the reason it's magnetite is because you have iron. Water coming off your reaction, okay, and so it oxidizes the iron.
Any other questions? Well, I guess.
One other question.
Oh, okay.
Maybe I'll address this to both of you. Can you do you have any insight as to where this DOE program is going at this point? Are you still getting funding?
I don't know whether I'm getting funding or not. I'm not getting funding for the indirect program, but I may get funding through what they call the advanced concepts. So I'm not gonna. They had, let me back up. In the full program at DOE, they have in the past have what they call direct liquefaction, indirect liquefaction, and then some kind of advanced whatever it is. It's their, you know.
Advanced processes.
You know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's been a major shakeup in what they plan to do in the future. Some really big things have changed. First of all, pretty much direct liquefaction is going to go away out there. And for probably some good reasons. It's because coal is very unpopular, direct liquefaction doesn't have a lot of support, whereas indirect, Fischer Tropes, there's a lot of support for that right now because of the synergy with gas, and sort of thing, gas, you know, liquefaction. So they see politically as a really good idea for them to stay in that area. So I don't know if Bert knows whether for sure how much or whether he's funded this year, but I know that I'm only going to be funded through the third area, but that's okay. You know, money isn't money. but to me, what it says is that they consider, because that's supposed to be their long-term research, that they do consider that to be a future of their programs. And their goal is, right now they have a wild eye program they call Vision 21, where they want to build something that can take any sort of feed, you know, from tires to coal to whatever, and come out with something liquid. So I'm not sure how long that plan will last, but because in the past, when they have tried to do what they call co-processing, their economic studies have showed that when you add, like when you co-process coal and plastic, that it makes it more expensive when you add coal to the process. So it makes them look bad, so they don't really want to kind of continue that. So anyway, so I'm not really sure. There's a lot of flux going on. But I do know that the indirect Fischer Tropes program is pretty healthy and
lower than that. That's good. Bert?
No, Well, we're optimistic we'll get some funding for 3 more years. The question is how much and whether the gas to liquids will fund part of, in addition to the coal.
That's what I wondered, if there was a trend to gas liquids and coal.
There's a real strong effort to try to get those programs together, along with the Office of Transportation Technology diesel.
And some companies are at least expressing interest in us testing some catalysts for them. So, right now, companies seem more interested than DOE. But we're still optimistic it'll continue for 3 more years.
That's good to hear.
At some level. We would prefer, obviously, at a high level instead of at a low level.